Coming up, proof that when we could only meet one person outside, one of Boris Johnson's top officials invited more than 100 to Downing Street drink.
It's the ITV News at 10.
Some news tonight that is really hard to credit. You will recall all too well that very first lockdown in the spring of 2020. The novelty of it, the isolation, for many, the fear, the vast majority of us religiously observing the rules, and by late May, the relief of a very slight easing.
You can meet one person outside your household in an outdoor public place.
But on that very day, we can reveal Boris Johnson's most senior official sent an email inviting more than 100, yes, 100 people to a party in Downing Street that the Prime Minister himself attended.
All of that, as you know, is the subject of a proper investigation by Sue Gray.
So have you already been interviewed by Sue Gray? And if not, do you object to her questioning you again about this?
All that is subject for an interview, for an investigation by Sue Gray.
It is just impossible to wrap your head round it. You couldn't have a wedding. Only close family could go to funerals. You couldn't visit old, frail, perhaps even dying relatives in care homes at all. But the people who made and enforced those laws were planning an enormous party. The reaction to Paul's story tonight has been furious. Opposition MPs said enough was enough.
Many people that see the evidence now will not only think that Boris Johnson's lies are catching up with him, but will see it as absolutely despicable when they were actually told to follow the rules. Boris Johnson and Number 10 were breaking the rules.
Up and down the country, people have been reminding themselves of the mood of that first lockdown and finding our revelations hard to believe.
4 days after my dad died, Boris Johnson thought he would make the most of the weather with a bring-your-own-booze party.
Also on the programme tonight, Djokovic out of detention and back on the court in Australia. But will the government there cancel his visa again? Are we drifting towards conflict with Russia? James has the latest on Putin's brinkmanship and Mary Berry and the search for a platinum pudding to mark the Queen's Jubilee.
This is ITV News at 10 with Tom Bradby.
Good evening. There have been so many chapters in the COVID story now with often bewildering rule changes that it does take a moment to cast your mind back to the novelty of that very first lockdown in the spring of 2020. We were all struggling through an unprecedented period of isolation, trying to look after ourselves and protect others. There was barely anything we were allowed to do. Large gatherings, indeed any gathering at all, was illegal. People missed funerals and you couldn't even visit relatives in care homes. And the vast majority of us observed the rules religiously. By May the 20th, the relief of a very slight easing. You could meet one, just one, other person outdoors. The then culture secretary went on television that day to reaffirm the message. But just hours earlier, one of Boris Johnson's top civil servants invited more than 100 Downing Street staff to a bring-your-own-booze party in the Number 10 garden. Yes, you did hear that right. More than 100. The email invite, which we've obtained, says it would be nice to make the most of the lovely weather. We understand more than 40 actually went, among them the Prime Minister himself. Of all the scandals that have beset Boris Johnson recently, this feels like it could be the most toxic.
May 2020, and despite high temperatures, we were enduring the lows of lockdown.
It depends on all of us, the entire country, to follow the advice.
There will be penalties for those who break these mandatory measures.
But while we were told to meet in twos, in Downing Street, they met in their tens, despite what ministers were telling us.
You can meet one person outside your household in an outdoor public place.
Yet just a few hours before that press conference, the Prime Minister's principal private secretary, one of his most senior civil servants, sent a very different message to over 100 Downing Street staff. In his email, Martin Reynolds wrote, Hi all. After what has been an incredibly busy period, we thought it would be nice to make the most of this lovely weather and have some socially distanced drinks in the number 10 garden this evening. Please join us from 6 p.m. and bring your own booze. We're told 30 to 40 people did, including the Prime Minister and his wife.
Many people that see the evidence now will not only think that Boris Johnson's lies are catching up with him, but will see it as absolutely despicable when they were actually told to follow the rules. Boris Johnson and Number 10 were breaking the rules.
At the time of the Downing Street drinks, you could only meet one person outside of your household, outdoors, in a public place. Large gatherings were illegal, weddings were banned, and funerals could only be attended by those in the same household or close family members.
Did you and Carrie attend the Downing Street party that was organised by Martin Reynolds on the 20th of May?
All that, as you know, is the subject of a proper investigation by Sue Gray.
So have you already been interviewed by Sue Gray? And if not, do you object to her questioning you again about this?
All that is subject for an interview, for an investigation by Sue Gray.
He's referring to the senior civil servant who's also investigating multiple other gatherings, including this one 5 days earlier, which shows staff, including Martin Reynolds, as well as the Prime Minister and his wife, sitting in the Number 10 garden with wine and cheese.
So she loved dancing. She was a very people person.
As Downing Street staff got together in May 2020, Valerie and her 98-year-old mother were kept apart. Marjorie died alone in hospital.
After 10 minutes, we had to go. And they rang us during the night, rang me during the night, to say that she'd passed away. It was the worst passing that I could possibly have hoped for her. Just 10 minutes, that's not long enough to even drink a glass of wine, never mind about have a cheese and wine party. Surely they must know how people were feeling, but to still go ahead with that, it couldn't be any worse for us. It's absolutely mind-blowing.
Today the Prime Minister was trying to focus minds on the booster programme. But yet again tonight, the question is whether Downing Street was immune to the rules. Paul Brand, News at 10.
Well, as the news of Paul's story spread tonight, we've probably all gradually been casting our minds back to the mood of that first lockdown. You will no doubt remember the relief of that slight easing when it came and the debates that went with it. Yes, you could meet a friend, but not their wife or husband or partner at the same time. And as Carl has found out tonight, the more people have thought about it, the more angry they have become.
When bereaved families went to see Boris Johnson in Downing Street, he met them in the garden. Hannah Brady, whose father Sean died of COVID, remembers showing the Prime Minister a photo of her dad in hospital.
I showed him a picture of my dad on a ventilator, which I've never shown anybody before. And he looked me in the eyes and said that he'd done all he could to save him. But 4 days after my dad died, Boris Johnson thought he would make the most of the weather with a bring your own booze party in Number 10 Downing Street.
How does that make you feel now about your meeting with the Prime Minister and what he said to you?
When I mentioned the date of the 16th of May, which is the day when my dad died, the first thought probably in his head was, oh, we had a really good knees up 4 days after that in this garden. Wasn't that fun? They knew full well what they were doing was wrong.
And even Conservative MPs think a price will have to be paid for what went on here.
I think everybody would be angry about that. And as I said at the time when these news stories were broken and before Christmas, that, you know, if anybody's broken the rules, they have to be held accountable and face the consequences.
Some have faced consequences. Illegal parties have been broken up, organisers prosecuted. Today's revelation increases the pressure on the police to act.
People were being charged. People were being criminalised because they broke the law. Here is prima facie evidence of government breaking its own law. When we all voted for legislation that would criminalise people, we've had the Prime Minister that's invited people, or his office that invited people to a mass party.
Amongst voters who couldn't even go to the pub at the time of the Downing Street party, there is a growing backlash.
I quite like Boris, but I'm very disappointed by this news. It's sad, really, because, you know, when I spent all that time not visiting my family.
I don't believe most of the things he says now because of this. And even to do with COVID still, anything that he speaks about on the news, I just think it's lies most of the time, if I'm honest.
Tory MPs are aware of that anger, but are also asking themselves if the Prime Minister has what it takes to salvage his reputation. Carl Dinan, News at 10, Westminster.
Well, to discuss the ramifications of this, I'm joined by both Robert and, of course, Paul. Paul, I think most people watching this tonight will be doing, I guess, what I've been doing most of the evening, which is sort of thinking back to that period. And it was a great relief when we could meet one person. And I remember everyone was having a debate. Oh, are you going around to your parents? Well, are you only going to, you know, meet one of them? It was a huge thing. And yet 100 people... I mean, what was your reaction when you saw this email?
Well, Tom, I think there's a devastating simplicity to this story. So unlike the other parties where there was talk of, you know, was it a work meeting, was there cheese and wine, whatever jokes, whatever excuses they came up with then, this one is inexcusable. This was lockdown 1.0. We all remember what was allowed because it was virtually nothing. You couldn't go to hospital to see a relative. You couldn't go around to your granny's garden for a drink, and you certainly couldn't take 100 of your colleagues with you to do that either. And yet that is exactly pretty much what happened in Number 10. This email proves it. And tonight, Number 10 isn't commenting on this story. They say they won't while there's this internal investigation. But after weeks of denials, what the Prime Minister isn't denying tonight is that this party happened and that he himself was there.
But the email from one of his most senior officials says, we were thinking, we invite you. Who's we?
Yeah, unless it's the royal we. It's really interesting that, Tom, because what is Martin Reynolds meaning by the word we? He speaks on behalf of the Prime Minister. He works very closely with the Prime Minister. Was it Boris Johnson who was in on this idea to have a drinks party? And tonight there is huge pressure on Martin Reynolds to resign. There's huge pressure on the Met Police to investigate. In the past few minutes, they've said they are in touch with the Cabinet Office about all of this. But the pressure extends, I think, to Boris Johnson in a way that it hasn't done before. Will he now give evidence to this internal inquiry? If he does, that's only where the questions begin. And for the first time, I can't see that he has any answers.
Robert, can I just throw that to you? Before Christmas, there was tremendous pressure on the Prime Minister. You sense that lifted a little bit over Christmas, but here we are, arguably in the worst position for him he's been in.
So it wasn't so much the pressure lifted, it's just we had another crisis,
yeah.
Omicron.
Yeah.
So, look, this is a Prime Minister, a politician, who famously mud gets thrown at him and it somehow falls off, he survives. But this does feel to me like the most serious crisis he has faced as Prime Minister. Looks to me, as Paul mentioned, that the Met Police will feel they have no option but to investigate. It's very difficult to see how this was not an illegal party. There is another issue for the Prime Minister, which is he has repeatedly told the House of Commons that there were no parties and that no COVID rules were broken in Downing Street. Now, he may say that he was referring only to the December party that Paul broke his brilliant scoop about, but actually he, on a number of occasions, seemed to be speaking more widely than that. But also, you know, he was... you know, at a party. There is no doubt about it. I mean, I have spoken to people who were witnesses there, and they say he was there, his wife was there. You know, she was, I mean, perhaps it's a trivial detail, but it just shows you, I suppose, the sort of sense to which they were observed. She was drinking gin, I'm told, for example. Now, you know, when you have that level of corroboration, Boris Johnson can no longer rely on the form of words that he's used up to now, which is, I've been advised there were no parties. How can you be advised if you were at a party? Labour, I think, will put an urgent question tomorrow in the House of Commons. They will demand that the Prime Minister comes and explains himself. Now, Martin Reynolds is in charge of the Downing Street building. As Paul again says, very likely that he will resign. I think if he resigns, however, it makes it harder for the Prime Minister. You know, Theresa May sees her officials misbehaving. The minister says to me, she would say, stop. Prime Minister apparently went to a party and enjoyed it. He's in an incredibly difficult position tonight.
OK, to be discussed tomorrow and probably beyond. But for now, thank you very much indeed. Well, let's move on to some other news. And set free by a court of law today, Novak Djokovic immediately returned to the tennis court to train. In a victory his family said surpassed any Grand Slam triumph, which seems a bit surprising, but never mind, a judge overturned the cancellation of his visa and ordered his release from detention in Melbourne. His supporters celebrated like a 10th Australian Open title was already his. And despite public anger, Djokovic insisted he wants to stay and compete. There is still a chance he may not. The government is threatening to cancel his visa all over again.
Such is the depth of feeling surrounding Novak Djokovic's detention. Police were on hand to control supporters, celebrating the decision to release him after 4 nights confined to an immigration hotel. Posing on court shortly after his visa was reinstated, the world number one said, despite all that has happened, I want to stay and try to compete at the Australian Open. Thank you all for standing with me through all this. In Serbia, his family expressed their relief at today's developments.
The whole process was not about tennis and tournament and Australian Open. It was more about the justice being called out and about the things that they did in there and you know, we're grateful for the justice system of Australia, and I'm sure that, you know, the justice will go on and the truth will, you know, be truthful all the way.
Do you have a message for Australia?
Djokovic's medical exemption was based on catching COVID last month. So why, his family was asked, was he apparently pictured at a public event indoors the day after he says he tested positive?
Was he at an event on the 17th of December?
Okay, so this press conference is adjourned at the moment. Thank you for attention.
Djokovic may be the world's best, but after spending so much of the past week cooped up, and given the inevitable frustrations that must go with that, has the defending champion got the resilience to be at his best next week?
This is not obviously ideal preparation. He's already lost 4 or 5 days now in detention. If this goes on, the emotions, the energy that he spent on this and mental and, of course, physically not being able to train, I just don't know how he can recover emotionally from this.
Australia's immigration minister still has the power to cancel Djokovic's visa again. But in the likely event he doesn't, Djokovic can expect more uncomfortable questions and an unpredictable welcome once the tournament gets underway. Steve Scott, News at 10.
While Mr. Djokovic may not be a fan of vaccines, today Boris Johnson urged those who still haven't had the COVID jab to come forward. It's hoped the vaccine drive and the seemingly mild effects of Omicron can allow restrictions to be eased. One option is cutting the time people spend in isolation from 7 days to 5, something the PM said he would do if the scientists approve. And Emily joins us to discuss the idea. Emily, we talked, didn't we, the other night about kind of looking beyond, you know, living with COVID, do we test and all the rest of it? But this cutting of isolation, how likely do you think is it to happen?
I think it's pretty likely. I think there is a reasonable chance this will happen. The government has really changed its tone on it, and given the speed at which they appear to have shifted their position, I think there really is a reasonable chance. The Prime Minister said he's looking at it. Yes, as you said, he wants to wait for the science. But I don't think the science is quite there yet, so I don't know how imminent this really is. But Downing Street really is under pressure to try and alleviate this staff shortages problem they have. And of course, cutting the isolation period would help resolve that. The problem with that is that it comes with risks. Up to about 30% of people are still infectious with COVID on day 5. So I think there's real division among the scientific community over this. There are some scientists I spoke to this afternoon had real differing opinions of it. One said that actually it probably isn't going to make that much difference given where we are with the pandemic and how much COVID there is in the community. Another scientist was very cautious. I think that is the majority view, that actually it will help to spread the disease, obviously, but also there is still real uncertainty about how infectious we remain with Omicron. And the Health Security Agency says that it's constantly reviewing the science. There are more studies ongoing. But I think, as you say, this is also about really setting the groundwork for us to begin to live with COVID.
OK, Emily, thank you very much indeed. Now, since the Grenfell Tower fire, many flat owners have been asked to pay eye-watering sums to have potentially dangerous cladding removed from their building. Today, Housing Secretary Michael Gove promised that would end. He said the financial burden will no longer fall on people living in buildings higher than 11 metres. And he's given developers until March to come up with a solution. Mr Gove had a warning for companies which have cut corners and missold dangerous products. "We are coming for you," he said. Russian and American officials appear to have made little progress in high-level talks designed to reduce tensions over Ukraine. For its part, Russia insists it has no plans to invade, despite massing around 100,000 troops near the border. But it's still demanding some pretty major concessions. Not actually involved in today's talks were the Ukrainians themselves, but their deputy foreign minister told us they trust the US to look after their interests.
This doesn't look like a country on the verge of war, invasion, possible occupation. With the Orthodox Christmas just over, Ukrainians are still in holiday mood, trying where possible not to think about the troops and tanks lined up on their border. But of course, everyone here knows that nations much greater than theirs are right now discussing their future. In Geneva today, it was like the Cold War had never ended. The US and Russia discussing European security with no European at the table. Today's talks do seem to have gone as well as could be expected, the Americans saying they'll take no decisions without the Ukrainians being on board. The Russians have dialed back the rhetoric somewhat, but continue to insist on things that are most unlikely to be conceded.
Ukraine and Georgia will never, ever become members of NATO. That would be a welcome change to the better in the position of NATO. We are fed up with loose talk, half promises.
Back in Kiev, the country's deputy foreign minister, who herself fled her home in Crimea after the last Russian invasion, doesn't think her country is going to be sold out.
Do you trust the Americans not to betray you at this stage?
US is our strategic partner. We have to be very clear, saying to Russia that what could they expect in case if they attack Ukraine one more time. The second is the economic thing, is exactly the number of sanctions or those instruments of sanctions that will be immediately exploited as soon as Russia does what they can consider doing.
If he does invade, can Ukraine defend itself?
Yes.
They have been preparing. We were taken to an underground bunker in the capital, a legacy of the nuclear fears back in the Cold War. Alexander Kalugin has been overseeing its refurbishment, ready for a new conflict.
Are you worried?
Of course, he said. I'm a 30-year military veteran. I know the dangers. Russia, of course, already occupies part of Ukraine. A wall of photographs commemorates the thousands of soldiers who have died and are still dying in eastern Ukraine in the last 8 years. But what the world is trying to avert now would be much worse, much more deadly, and the greatest threat to European peace in many decades.
And James joins me now from Kiev. James, no progress, it seems, today. Is there any reasonable sign of a resolution to this crisis?
The important thing that happened today, Tom, is that the talks didn't break down. Such was the nature of Russia's demands, not just what you heard there, that NATO and Georgia be legally banned from ever joining NATO, but that effectively NATO roll itself back to the position it was in at the end of the Cold War, effectively leaving Russia's sphere of influence back where it was during the Cold War. Well, I mean, there was no way that it was almost as if these demands have been designed to be rejected and therefore to make an excuse for war. Well, today at least, and there's a long way to go in this, that doesn't seem to have happened. But President Putin has, metaphorically speaking, marched his men up a very, very big hill. He's put a huge invasion army into the field. He's told his people that this is a security issue of national importance to Russia. And somehow the Americans have to find a way through these talks of giving him a way of getting back down, climbing back down again. That's not going to be easy. And that's why this is so dangerous.
OK, James, thank you very much indeed. Well, in the US, a faulty electric heater is being blamed for starting a fire which killed 17 people in New York, with 8 children among the victims. Many who died were suffocated by thick black smoke which billowed through the high-rise, trapping residents inside. Dozens of people are still being treated in hospital, with some in a critical condition. In just under a month, on February the 6th, it will be 70 years since the Queen's accession, making her the first British monarch to reach a platinum jubilee. The nation is being encouraged to join the celebrations with parties, pageantry and puddings. That's right, an expert panel including none other than the Queen of Baking, Dame Mary Berry, will judge a competition to create a platinum pudding. So now, it's over to you.
We might not have met in mass numbers for some time, but similar crowds to the ones for the Diamonds Jubilee are expected for the Platinum Jubilee this summer, another milestone for this Queen.
We're echoing the procession that Her Majesty did on her coronation day.
It's hard to imagine on a Monday in midwinter, but in June the Mall will host the main Jubilee pageant as it marks the 7 decades of the Queen's reign.
There is enormous enthusiasm for this.
Yeah, and
isn't it? It is for her. It is for her. It's respect for her and what she's done and what she's given the country. And I think that people in their hundreds of thousands will converge on London.
The big Saturday night concert will take place here with a stage right in front of Buckingham Palace. The ballot for tickets opens next month, but the lineup is still a closely guarded secret. But when you're the longest-serving monarch in British history, few of the world's big artists are likely to turn down an invitation to perform. The long bank holiday weekend will start with the Queen's birthday parade, Trooping the Colour. Beacons will also be lit that day across the UK and the Commonwealth. On the Friday, a service of thanksgiving for the Queen's reign will be held at St Paul's Cathedral. The Saturday will see that big music concert in front of Buckingham Palace. And on Sunday, the Jubilee pageant in London will be complemented by street parties across the country. And today, a new competition, which will be judged by, among others, Mary Berry. It is to invent a new pudding, a platinum pudding, if you will. A recipe that might last as long as coronation chicken, which, as its name suggests, was invented for the Queen's coronation all that time ago.
You can be part of history, and we want people to actually look at the life of the Queen and the work of the Queen, because she has done so many amazing things and she has such a character. So there's so many things to take inspiration from for the pudding.
A pudding, a pageant or a pop concert, but above all else, it will be a moment in history. Chris Shipp News at 10.
And finally, 10 years before the Queen's reign began, she was treated to a special performance for her 16th birthday from the Forces' sweetheart, Vera Lynn. She appeared after a secret request from King George VI, a request which has come to light in a new exhibition of Dame Vera's personal effects. Before her death, she was known as the singer whose voice kept up morale during the Second World War, but her artistic talents did not end there.
Keep smiling through, just like you always do.
For years, she used her music to raise morale, but Dame Vera Lynn also figured out how to raise her own spirits with the help of a paintbrush and canvas. The result? Hundreds of paintings never seen publicly before, some now on display in the Sussex Museum and Gallery she was patron of. She painted watercolours of flowers and landscapes near her home in the South Downs. And many unnamed people sat for her as she took lessons in London at the painting school of the renowned artist Arthur Siegel. This is just a small portion of her artworks. And Dame Vera's daughter, who has spent more than a year sorting through her possessions for this exhibition, hopes to find out more.
If somebody's relative, if the person themselves are no longer with us, it would be lovely to hear from somebody who said, oh, that was my great aunt Flora or something, who sat. That would be great fun to be able to speak to somebody in the family.
That's quite an accolade to have, isn't it? I sat for Dame Vera Lynn.
Yes, absolutely.
Dame Vera was a prolific artist. Even when she was sitting in a dressing room waiting to go on stage, she was creating works like this tapestry. She kept many items documenting her 9 decades in public life. Her gowns have sat in a trunk at home for years until now. Her time spent touring Burma to visit the troops was amongst her most treasured memories, and her local museum is delighted that they are showing many of the items before they go to a national collection.
I think being able to see all of her possessions, belongings and other objects brought together like this in the village where she lived for so long is a really special thing.
My love for you is as wide as the ocean.
Dame Vera's music and its significance to generations is legacy enough, but it turns out she left a lot more, even if the details of who she immortalised on canvas have yet to be uncovered. Nina Nanart, News at 10 in East Sussex.
That's it for tonight. We'll meet again tomorrow, no doubt, with more news of Downing Street parties, or at least their consequences. Good night. Thanks for watching.